So after that introduction, I won't say pretty much anything about myself, except that I started another user group recently for JavaScript. And you can find me on Twitter on this weird handle, or you can ask me later. So today we're going to talk about something that I'm pretty sure all of you love to do and love to experience in your work. That's documentation, of course. I don't see anyone running, but perhaps the other rooms are full, so bear with me for a minute. I have the same feelings as you. Documentation is usually long, or too long, or too short, or not well written. It's pretty much useless because of that. And the business changes their minds so often that it can be kept up to date. So in the end, we just end up with a wiki somewhere that no one bothers to check or to improve. Or even worse, a bunch of PDF files stored in a cloud somewhere. In fact, this is plain boring, and I don't want to talk about it for an hour. So we'll just skip it and try not to use the word documentation anymore, at least for the time being. Instead, we are going to talk about specifications. What that means is usually some kind of format that's easier to parse with code, or generally machine readable, easier to write because it has some structure, and we as developers love structure, and it can be used for more than just plain old HTML documentation. But you still have to write something down. It's not magical, it's not automatic, you can just run something on your code and get things going. Well, you can, but you shouldn't. But after you explore the variety of tools that are available and maybe play with the specs yourself, you find that you can do some cool things with it and help your process a little bit. Are you convinced yet? Should I stop or we need to dig deeper? Yeah, I guess so. In our work, we usually encounter a lot of unfinished documentation. And you see references to some resource somewhere, but there's no documentation for it. You start poking around, maybe do some requests, try to guess the responses, and maybe get things going, maybe not. Or maybe I've had cases when I needed to basically intercept all the traffic and see what the API does, actually, based on that. Which is not good. And even after you manage somehow to come up with an integration, whether it's a third-party API or the API that the other team wrote, they decide to change something and everything is broken again. Whether it's a field, a type somewhere, it pretty much breaks everything. If you have tests, you catch 30. If you don't, it breaks in production and it's even more fun. So basically, maybe 6 months ago, I was started thinking about this when I inherited a project that had zero documentation, zero tests, and it was basically going back and forth with the mobile developers about how the API works. They want one thing, then it changes, then the backend developer decides to do something else, and everything is broken, everyone is screaming, and it's not a pleasant experience. And through the user group, I observed that quite a lot of people have the same problems. In our strive to be agile, we tend to drop some parts of the processes we usually use. So we end up with little upfront design, sometimes. And I know what you're going to say. This is a PHP conference. We are all competent developers. We do design our classes. We do design our code. We spend time learning about design patterns and methodologies and yada yada. But when it comes to an API, a lot of the times people just take something from the database and shove it down to the clients and continue with their day, which is, let's say, not ideal. it results in an HTTP-enabled database, which is useless, pretty much. And when we start making changes a little bit faster, we forget to announce them. And when there is no documentation, people can't know that we actually changed something. And things are broken, yet again. Instead of saving time and reducing waste, we are actually creating more of it, and it comes with a lot of stress. We don't go to that meeting to discuss the design, because we're going to get so much done. And then we go to 5 other meetings to fix the bugs. Again, not ideal. So the common things I've identified are that when we move fast, our changes are usually not tested properly, because we need to ship that update as fast as possible. Usually, the clients need to wait for the backend to be implemented before they can start working on the UI or the integration in general. And with third-party APIs, even with bigger companies that are supposed to do things properly, I will not name anyone this time, but the documentation doesn't match with the actual API, and when you go on GitHub and check the SDK, it says something completely different. And you're back at Stack Overflow, trying to come up with a useful solution. And there is also the case where, as I mentioned, a lot of people just shove up some JSON to the client and everything breaks. And then the rest is stupid, and we try to find other solutions that are shiny and new and awesome for some particular use cases. This is, by the way, shamelessly stolen from Phil Sturgeon. You should definitely read his book and his books on this topic and APIs in general. And the simplest solution will be to keep doing what we are doing and just ignore documentation and ignore design, and no problem. We can buy a crystal ball for everyone and we can just guess. But that's not a solution, is it? So let's come up with a plan. We can go specification first and actually use that specification, not just for documentation, but actually as a design tool and a communication tool for our team or teams, or it scales pretty well. Basically, nothing gets worked on if it's not defined. Pretty much like what you do with TDD. You first come up with the use case, you write some tests, and then start working on the code. And then once we are happy with the design, we can treat that specification as a contract and basically verify that our assumptions are right and make the API work the way we expect it to work, force it to do it generally by tests. And this way of thinking got me to a point where I was walking by the sea, Varna is by the Black Sea, and I was thinking about the talk and the whole thing with specifications and contracts. And pretty much everything around us is some sort of API. We interact with it. This thing is out of wood. I know I can touch it. I know I can probably move it around, break my laptop. And probably shouldn't do it because I'm going to break my laptop. And with the sea, there are some other rules. When you're young, you are first taken to the beach by your parents or someone else, and they explain to you the ground rules. Don't go in too deep, you're going to drown. Don't go without a lifeguard. If the weather is bad, you have no business in the water. Generally, don't die. But then, in our work, when we start working on actual APIs, we every so often basically let our users, our clients, our colleagues drown in the sea of broken endpoints and undocumented responses and requests and so on. So the game plan here is pretty simple. On paper it sounds complicated, but really it's not. We talk to each other, maybe in a meeting if everyone is working in the same office, maybe through pull requests on GitHub or somewhere else. we produce a specification about the design we are going to use. Then from that specification, we generate a mock server and some documentations they can follow to actually implement something. Then they can start playing with it, the clients, start to integrate it, see where it works, where it doesn't, come up with some feedback. Then we go back, refine it, then go all the way back to step one, work more on the spec, generate the docs and the mock servers again. And once we are happy, we use that spec in integration or contract test, depending on what you have at the moment. And only then we start to work on the actual server code. This helps us prevent the constant back and forth between the clients and the backend developers. And actually saves time because the feedback loop is shorter. You don't need to write those 50 lines of PHP again and again just to make some changes. The benefits are pretty obvious. The specification becomes the single source of truth for our design. If it's not there, it doesn't exist. And we should enforce that by code reviews and, as I said, with tests. We always come back to the tests. Then the documentation and the tests can't be out of date because they are generated from it, which also helps. When we make the writing easy, people are going to actually follow it. And we can sort of work independently and generally save time by parallelizing that work. Of course, to do that, we need to pick a format. Over the years, there were several variations of pretty much the same things. And spoiler alert, I am going to talk about OpenAPI in the end. But I still think there is value to see what's available out there. And maybe one of the other formats will be better for your use case. First, maybe 3 years ago, I stumbled upon API Blueprint, and it seemed like the coolest thing ever. I can write Markdown and get some beautiful HTML documentation, maybe run it through some tools, get some tests out of it. Turns out Markdown isn't the best format for this, because you still have to write quite a lot, and you're basically forcing one tool to do a job it's not supposed to do. And it's somehow not that active anymore, and there aren't a lot of tools for it. Then RAML was supposed to revolutionize everything. They came up with a whole set of tools for modeling, for design, testing, and so on, and somehow faded in the background, and I'm not sure if it's even developed anymore. But historically, it's probably one of the things that led to the development of OpenAPI. Then recently, I discovered JSON schema through learning about OpenAPI. It's basically a sort of language to describe JSON documents. You can define types on pretty much everything. You can describe how they can be composed or replaced. It even has a sister spec for hypermedia controls, which can be used in the runtime to actually develop RESTful APIs. And finally, I settled on OpenAPI because we aren't developing RESTful APIs. We are in the HTTP plus JSON business, mostly. The initiative is very interesting because somehow around the spec, maybe 3 years ago, it was developed by a single company, then they decided to open source it and donate it. And a couple other companies joined, and now there are, I think, 20 or 30, including Google, IBM, Microsoft, eBay, pretty much every big company that has an API is part of the initiative. It's under the Linux Foundation. It has funding. It has a technical steering committee that decides what to do. It's not going anywhere. It's only going to get better from this point on. But you probably know it by its own name, Swagger. But please don't call it that. It's way too confusing, and a lot of people still think about the spec as swagger. It should stay in the tools only. The company that initially developed the spec is called SmartBear, and they have a set of tools called Swagger Hub that basically works with OpenAPI specifications. It's sort of good if you need that. You can write it in YAML or JSON, whichever is less painful for you. I prefer YAML. With all its problems, it's still better than writing JSON by hand. It's very actively developed. Basically, since the last time I gave this talk 6 months ago, I had to change half of the slides because they made changes all the time. The community is super active and super friendly. You can go on GitHub, ask questions, even listen on the meetings of the steering committee. And you can be involved. You can actually propose changes. And if they are good, they're going to work on them and improve the spec for everyone. The only problem with active development is that tooling can't catch up fast enough. And sometimes we need to wait a little bit. Now we're going to jump in sort of a crash course, but please, if you are going to use it in your project, read the actual specification, because in 20 minutes I can't cover all the possibilities, and it's easier to reference the real thing when you are actually working with it. Currently the best place to read the spec is on Swagger's website, which is also very confusing, but what can you do? So, the basic structure of our OpenAPI file will look something like this. It has some information about the API, what version of the spec it uses. This is so tools can break when they detect 302 instead of 301, but they are actually following Semver, so tools shouldn't break, but they do. You can add some information about the API, where people can locate it, and a list of resources would actually describe what it does. The information part is probably the most boring one, but also probably one of the most important parts. Here's the place where you can actually describe what the API is going to do, what version it is currently at, and usually if you have multiple versions, which unfortunately we need to do sometimes, you can define the version here, and you usually keep two separate files for the different versions, if they are different enough. And this is also the place to add contact information, licenses, terms of use, and so on. I think the contact information is particularly important because when people have problems, they need to know who can help them, even if it's the person sitting on the desk right next to them. They still need to have that in a place that's easy to find. Now, the server's object isn't really very exciting. It's usually a simple URL where you can start making calls to the API, and the tools use it to generate SDKs, servers, and other types of code generation. It can be as simple as one URL or multiple, depending on how many environments you have. Or you can go crazy with URI templates and perhaps do something like this for maybe a situation where each user has their own API somewhere, and you don't want to describe all of them in the same file. But the most important, maybe, part is actually what our API does. Because if it does nothing, it's useless to our clients. And in this case, this is just a list of all the resources with their identifiers and all the operations that can be applied to the particular resource. And this is where the spec is trying to push you in a certain kind of design, which is not entirely compatible with the RESTful architecture, but it is the most closer one to the real world, because I haven't seen many actually RESTful APIs out there. Each resource or a path is described by its location and metadata about it. You will see the summary and description fields everywhere. For the purpose to fit the code on the slides, I haven't really expanded on anything, but you can go as long as you need to in the description, use Markdown and format it better and make it more useful. I really prefer to be as verbose as possible, so it can actually be used for good documentation afterwards. We can apply some tags to the paths for better organization and describe some parameters and the operations. If we dig deeper, we'll see how flexible the spec actually is. The parameters can describe pretty much every type of parameter, from path variables to query strings to headers, everything. In previous version, this is where you wrote the request bodies as well, but they fixed that. It's way easier now. And each parameter can actually have a schema that describes how you need to define it. What type it has, is it a simple string, an integer, boolean, or maybe even an array. There are several combinations of the style and export properties, which can help you define different types of arrays. This example results in a simple list of values that we see very commonly in query string parameters, and that's the basic HTTP GET form we are used to as PHP developers, and which is easy to parse. But the spec has all the options listed and described very well, so I won't go into that. Then we can describe some operations. Here there are many options for different additional metadata, like again, summaries, descriptions, parameters that are specific for that operation, headers go here as well. And in the responses section, you actually describe what the clients will get. This is the place where we also get into content negotiation. You can describe different content types. Pretty much anything that's a valid MIME type can go into the content object. Unfortunately, if you are using some media format like HOW or JSON API or something else, the spec doesn't help you at all, and you need to describe everything by yourself in the schema object. And you can also define ranges of responses here. Maybe all URLs have the same structure, no need to define the 401, 404, 403 in their own place. You just can say my 4xx responses will have this structure, deal with it. And the schema objects are very interesting part of the spec. It is generally JSON schema, but not really. They decided to change some things, add some things, remove some things, and pretty much all the JSON schema validators are useless for OpenAPI, and we need to write converters. But it supports the more important parts, like references and the options for composition and pretty much all the types. A schema object generally looks like this. You describe the type of resource you have here. In this case, it's an object. It has some properties. Some of the properties can be defined as required if you need to do that. In my case, they all be optional, which was stupid, but I can't fit it on the slides. What formats are not covered by a type can be expressed as a format on the string, like UIDs, addresses, phone numbers, emails, and this is again useful for validation, for mocking, and stuff like that. The bad thing in this case is the one major difference with JSON schema, that is the nullable thing. You can define the field like no or something else, but in OpenAPI there is a separate property, and in JSON schema you have union types for that. But they decided to skip it for some reason. But the good thing is that they are talking to each other, and very soon we'll be able to just use the real thing, and even more, we can use other formats for the schemas. Maybe you want to use JSON schema, maybe you're using XML and want to use XML schema or something like that, or even a completely different format. I don't think they'll define any restrictions on that. The draft is ready, and tooling should start to implement it, but so far I haven't seen anything that actually supports this. But the general syntax will be something like this. The references are probably the more developer-y thing in the whole spec, because you can use them to actually reuse part of what you've written already and not end up with 10,000 lines of YAML somewhere. It is a simple JSON object with a ref property, and it can reference external documents, parts of your document, parts of external document. It is pretty flexible. It looks like this. Nothing really fancy, but saves you a ton of time because you can come up with some structure and have a actually split up the spec and make it easy to work with. And when you get into working with JSON schema files, they are more useful when each document is described by its own schema. So you probably have a folder with JSON schemas for the different resources and then just reference them in the actual spec. And they have defined a place where you can store that if you don't want to split up in different files in the beginning. You can have schemas, responses, whole request bodies, examples. The examples are usually just what you expect the schema to generate in the end, the real JSON data, or there, it isn't really restricted. You can even add code examples here that can be displayed in the docs later. So this is not a complete description, but it can get you started if you follow along and write that down, which I don't expect to do here. But this is the boring part of the spec. The interesting thing is, what can we do with it? The easy thing is actually generate documentation and store it somewhere for people to look at. If you are using Swagger Hub, you'll probably use Swagger UI, which is ugly and doesn't function very well. And I don't really know what they were thinking, like, a list of things. I look at the YAML and understand better what's going on. But if you are paying for Swagger Hub, use it. Next, if you've seen Stripe's documentation, they have made popular this three-pane design. And there is a tool which is called Withershins and can read your spec and output a markdown file that's compatible with Slate, which is the tool that Stripe uses. A compromise, if you ask me. And the best one so far for me is Redoc. They have a nice CLI tool that can preview your documentation live. It looks nice. It's easy to use. The menu on the left is generated by the tags you define and the operations. So you can actually manipulate it through the spec and come up with a structure that actually makes sense for the users. On the right, it displays either some generated responses by the schema you have defined or actual examples that you have written. And also, you can add code examples with a vendor extension, just we're not really going to go there right now. And the CLI tool supports bundling everything into a single HTML file, which you can deploy somewhere and leave it be, ideally in a CI environment, so it's always updated. That's about it. It's written in React, if you like to choose tools based on the technology. Then to actually write a specification that is valid, because it's very easy to write YAML that's not valid and misspell some things and make the whole spec wrong. The best linter I've tried is called phpCE. It's developed by WeWork, and again, Phil Sturgeon is the main author of that. He pops up a lot in the OpenAPI space. It can linter specification, it supports rule sets. If you have some special rules defined for your company, you have a way to define those. Maybe your description shouldn't be longer than 300 words or something, or you require having tags everywhere, or it doesn't really have any restrictions. You can define anything, and it ships with a base of default rules that are good enough to start. It supports preview with Redoc, and if you want to write JSON schema today, this is your only option to include it in your OpenAPI spec later. The documentation is good, so you can check it out at GitHub. Editors. I prefer to write the YAML by hand. Previously, I used VS Code. It has a linter extension that goes to the spec wife and pops up some errors. It provides IntelliSense, which is the Microsoft term for code completion. It works, kind of. And it has some converters built in. It's good enough to start. Again, if you are paying for Swagger Hub, you have Swagger Editor, which is just a text editor in disguise. And you only get the live preview on the right and some confusing errors if you manage to screw up something in the spec. There are some graphical options. apiCurio is one of them. Last time I checked, it had some trouble with external references, but generally it works well. You have a bunch of boxes, you move them around, and at the end you have a spec that's actually good for something. One of the better graphical tools is just a simple web page, which supports importing your spec, again, moving some boxes, filling some forms, and exporting a YAML file. Unfortunately, you can't really use it locally. So you have to go to the whole import-export process every time, which is not ideal for me. It's a waste of time. But it works well enough for a graphical tool. And my current favorite is a PHP Storm plugin. The code completion works well, really well. It handles the references more than well. You can actually go and control or command click everything and go around the files and the spec. It has preview and Swagger UI, but what can you do? And for now it's free, but in the near future it might not be. I don't know what the author will decide to do. At least I hope it's not too expensive. So, because it's a really good option if you're already using PHP Storm, and we are keeping the spec in the backend code repository, so it's already there for everyone to edit. Once you're done with writing, linting, generating documentation, and other stuff that might be a little boring, you can get into code generation. Currently, the best tool that is not online is OpenAPI Generator. It's fork of Swagger CodeGen. Pretty much all the templates are updated. It supports pretty much any language under the sun, and most of the more popular PHP frameworks, and it generates somewhat good SDKs if you need to do that. It supports OpenAPI v3, which Swagger CodeGen doesn't, and I think the hosted version of Swagger Hub doesn't as well yet for code generation. Yeah, it's good. Some of the code it generates for the servers isn't something you would write by yourself, but it's a good start if you have a greenfield project and want to start working from the spec. Specifically for PHP, there is a tool that can generate PSR7 compatible SDKs. It's based on HTTP plug, so you can switch implementations for different scenarios if you need. But they added version 3 support last week, and when I tried to get it working before the talk, I couldn't. But maybe I didn't do something right. I'll probably write some issues and try to figure it out, because it seems like it's really good, and they are exploring how to start generating server-side code as well. But for now, it's probably better for a PHP SDK than the OpenAPI generator. Mock servers, there are some out there. Swagger Hub pops up everywhere. Their mock server is actually good and works with V3. But again, it's part of the, I think it's part of the paid options. If you need to run something locally, API Sprout is probably the best. It's written in Go. They provide executables, Docker containers. Unfortunately, for the time being, it just supports examples. If your schemas don't have examples, it say, sorry, I can't help you. But the author says he's going to work on that. And it's open source, so anyone can join. If you know Go well enough. I assume and know that probably a lot of you like Postman. I use it all the time to poke around in APIs. There is actually an API online that can help you convert an OpenAPI spec to Postman collections. And with a little bit of code, maybe my script is like 20 lines, you can upload your spec, get the Postman collection back, and push it to the Postman API. And if you're using Postman team, you can actually update the whole team at the same time and keep the collections in sync. So it prevents a little bit of frustration when your Postman collection is out of date. And it's not that hard to implement, as I said. There are some converters from OpenAPI schemas to JSON schema. Both tools are Node.js based, but they work. So I can't complain. Why would you do that? Basically, you get best of both worlds for now. You can write OpenAPI, convert it to JSON schema, and use that for front-end validation or server-side validation, tests, form generation even, and keep the everything in one place. Or you can go the other way around and keep the JSON schema separate, use it for the same things, and convert it back to OpenAPI for the things that need an OpenAPI spec. But it doesn't work really well. For example, you can probably get a test in PHP going something like this. You load the schema, maybe from a file. It doesn't really matter in this example. You call your API, get a response back, and try to see if it's valid according to the schema. The check will look something like this with Swagger's PHP JSON schema library. There are two libraries right now. This is the only one that supports the old version of JSON schema that OpenAPI uses, and its API is not particularly great, but it works. Previously, the leak of extraordinary packages had a one called JSON guard, which was pretty good, but it's abandoned now. But it's working. I've tried it in some smaller projects, and it's a good way. The only problem is that you need to do that for pretty much every endpoint in your API. If you want to do something yourself, there's actually a library that does the job of parsing the spec pretty well, I would say. I discovered it only recently and haven't really digged in to see how well it's maintained. Is it good? But on the surface, it works. It parses the spec, it returns the nicely formatted objects, and the API is actually quite pleasant to work with. And you can use it to also generate specs from your code if you want to do that. But if you are going to write annotations for every method, you're probably better off writing the spec. And that got me thinking, and I started experimenting with some tools that can actually go and test the whole API based on the spec. And the basic idea here is that you can just integrate in your current PHP unit setup. And provide a data provider which contains all the resources in the API, and you can pass it to some assertions that are pre-built. If you go to that repository currently, you will see nothing, just a README and some jumbled up code that I've been experimenting with. And the basic idea is to have something, a class in this case. I'll probably convert it to a proper iterator to integrate better with the data provider API. And which can read the file and export some an array with all the paths and their operations. So this should speed up the testing part, because this is probably the weakest thing in the whole ecosystem right now. There are some tools that are going to be able to get a spec file and test the API with actual requests, but they are not updated. They only support the old version of OpenAPI. And until they do, this is one of the options. I'm not sure where I'm going to go with that. Probably nowhere, but we'll see. I'm open to ideas if you need something like that. And with that, if you need more tools, there is a place for that. Again, maintained by Phil Sturgeon and Matt Trask. You probably know them from the community. It's a nice list with some tools separated by category and which version of the spec they support. It's great. And they keep it updated once tools add support for the new version. And that's about it. APIs are everywhere, so we might as well make the experience better for everyone involved. Thank you. I don't know if we have time for questions. I suppose we have. Yeah, maybe 5-10 minutes. No? Okay.
Hello, thanks for the talk. Wanted to ask, like you mentioned, references. Is it possible to include a reference and extend it, like remove some fields, add something else?
You can use the one-off and all-off syntax and JSON schema, but you can include it with some other things, but you can't really replace anything in the reference. You can probably have a bunch of schemas that define small parts of the whole thing and combine them together. You can do that, but you can't subtract anything at the moment.
So basically, if I wanted to say that I have a GET request and a POST request, and the GET request doesn't the POST request doesn't accept one field that GET returns, I would have to use two references, like one reference for the GET and one reference for the POST, and that are different to that one field.
Yeah, you can define the base. Usually in this case, the POST request won't have the ID in the request body, right? And you can define the rest of the fields somewhere in a schema object and then include that in the for the GET request and send it to the POST. There are some options. People are modeling it for extension and composition of different schemas in one place. You can, it's very well described in the spec. You can check it out there.
OK, thank you.
Hello, thank you for the talk. I have a question about the softwares to generate the code from the specification. So far, I used just the Swagger code gen, and I was not so satisfied, to be honest, with the code quality of the generated client. And maybe it's good for some starter project to test if your API works properly, but in production-ready code, what's your opinion? That should I use some code generator, which is some open source code generator, which generate code that will satisfy me, create my own generator, which I will be happy with that, or create the client manually?
Well, as with anything, it depends. The OpenAPI CodeGen thing is a little better than Swagger CodeGen because it's actually maintained and the templates are improved. You can define your own templates if you still want to use the tool to generate the clients automatically. You can just edit the templates to match your preference and use them instead of the provided ones. Yeah, that's one option.
Okay.
And you can write your own, yeah. That's always an option. Depends on how much time you want to spend on it.
Uh-huh. Okay, thank you.
Thanks. There was someone in the back, I think. Yeah.
It's about your test case library, which auto generates tests based on the OpenAPI YAML. is there a solution or a way how to use responses again in another request? For example, if you have a product group you're creating, and afterwards you want to create a product in that product group you just created.
All right. With the thing I'm playing with, you won't be able to do that. You probably need to write that test by hand. And I haven't seen a tool that can do that. Basically, most of them read the spec and start making requests and check the responses. So you, if you have a relationship like that, you need to write it by hand.
Okay, thanks.
Hello. I have a question about authorization. I saw in Swagger specification that there is OAuth authorization, and I don't know how it works. Could you explain that?
Yes, I skipped it intentionally to keep it a little bit shorter. They have expanded on what there was in the previous version of Swagger. In addition to OAuth, you also have the option to specify that the API uses API keys and a few other schemas for the auth. And the OAuth part supports more grants, but if your use case doesn't fit in the what's defined in the spec, you need to basically describe it manually. There are some options. If you are doing OAuth, you are pretty much covered by the spec, but you need to check it in the actual text. It is described quite well.
Yeah, because this requires interaction with user, so it's tricky, I think.
Yes, but OAuth is a standard. So if you say that you support OAuth with certain grants, that should be enough for the documentation.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, if there aren't any questions, thank you again.